We are going to discuss this morning an important subject, particularly in context of Mumbai, that is redevelopment of slum projects in Mumbai. As all of us know, larger parts of Mumbai are covered by slums, and today the real estate development is morely 90% or more is in respect of the slum redevelopment. The slum redevelopment therefore assumes importance, particularly in the city of Mumbai, because that is the only source, or rather substantial source, through which housing stock is created for general public, as well as the slum dwellers are rehabilitated, who generally are living in a very unhygienic, unsanitary and inhumane conditions. Now, when we talk about slums in Mumbai, that is something very, very ancient. Slums in Mumbai is not something of recent origin. As back as in 1933, the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act was amended to provide for slum improvement. Now, that is something several people get amused that in 1933, the concept of slum existed and it was felt necessary by the legislature in 1933 that the slums in Mumbai should be redeveloped. And therefore, a new chapter was added in the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act, that is Chapter 12A and Sections 354R to 354Q. That was a mini slum act from 1933. Very few slum pockets were redeveloped by Mumbai Municipal Corporation, but the scheme of the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act in Chapter 12A was exactly the same, which is the identifying the slum which are in inhuman conditions, unsanitary conditions, and not livable conditions for the general human beings. So that was the concept of slum recognized as back as in 1933. And the slum clearance and improvement was the concept introduced for Municipal Corporation that was operated from 1933 till 1971. Obviously, that did not prove sufficient for redevelopment of slums in Mumbai or getting rid of slums in Mumbai. And therefore, a comprehensive act was passed, that is Slum Improvement Act of 1971, which is the act which is functioning even today, which is what we are going to discuss this morning. Another legislation came in 1976, that is the MHADA Act, by which Maharashtra Housing and Area Development Board Authority was executed, and they were various regional boards created, including the Mumbai board. That act also has a provision for redevelopment of slums. In fact, one of the objects of MHADA Act is to have these slum clearance areas. Of course, that would go parallelly in accordance with the provisions of the Slums Act of 1971. So that was the third legislation which came in the history of Mumbai slums. Then a major impact happened in 1985. All of you would remember that Rajiv Gandhi, as a prime minister, at Congress session, which happened in December 1985, announced 100 crore package for Mumbai slum redevelopment. And as a result of that, the slum redevelopment scheme was introduced in 1985, under which about 86 schemes were implemented. And you will find there as a prime minister's slum rehabilitation project, there are about 86 projects which were developed under the 85 slum redevelopment scheme, which was introduced on the basis of grant given by the prime minister, that 100 crore grant. So that was a major boost for slum redevelopment, but it still not have any teeth because there was no incentive for builders or the landowners or the slum dwellers to come forward and have rehabilitation schemes developed. The major boost came for the first time in 1991 development control regulations, which are framed for Greater Mumbai under the provisions of Maharashtra Regional and Town Planning Act. DCR 3310, as we know, which even fortunately the same number has been continued even in development control and promotion regulations of 2034. So DCR 3310 was a short DCR which provided that these eligible slum dwellers and the slum pockets would be redeveloped in accordance with the provisions of Appendix 4. Appendix 4 provided elaborate procedure for finding out eligibility, etc., that we'll discuss. So that was the scheme which was introduced in 1991 by way of DCR 3310, read with Appendix 4. Now in 2034 DCR, Appendix 4 provisions have been merged in DCR 3310 itself. So 3310 today is a very, very self-contained and comprehensive legislation in so far as the redevelopment of slums is concerned. Of course, we have to go to the parent, go to the act, that is Slum Act also, for implementation of the slum scheme. So that was the next legislative step which came by way of DCR 3310 in 1991. Then, despite 3310 having come into force in 1991, the slum redevelopment had not picked up, and therefore the government of Maharashtra appointed a committee under the chairmanship of Mr. Afzal Purkar, former Chief Secretary of Maharashtra. He submitted a comprehensive report, and on that basis, a new chapter, or three chapters actually, were introduced in the Slum Act, that is chapters 1A, 1B, and 1C in 1996. Now that's something, a new mini legislation in relation to the slums, and that has virtually transformed the slum redevelopment from 1996 onwards. So now we have a parallel system under the Slum Act, original Slum Act, and a new system which has come into being under Chapter 1A. And that's today the major source of slum redevelopment as well as major source of litigation also for the lawyers. Now, that came in 1996. That has been amended in 2012, 2018, and there are some other minor amendments. So that's the one source of legislation, that is Chapter 1A, 1B, and 1C. Then we have the Parent Slum Act and the DC regulations. 3310 has now been substituted with 3310, which is a comprehensive provision in Development Control and Promotion Regulations of 2034. So that's broadly the scheme of the legislative provisions. Now, if you go back to the 1971 Act, 1971 Act broadly provided for two or three things. One is the definition of slum in Section 4. Now, the slum basically has been defined in Slum Act as well as in DC regulation. So when we talk about slum, what it says is that the area which is a source of danger, to health, safety, and convenience, or it is inadequate in provisions of sanitation or hygiene, or it is occupied by buildings which are unfit for human habitation, or there is no sanitary provisions, or there are streets are so narrow that there is no light, air, and other ventilation. So in other words, it's a lacking, the provisions are lacking for human habitation, either as a cluster or as a particular building. So that's broadly the definition of slum described in Section 4 of the Act. And that's very, very crucial because in DC regulations also, Section 4 of the Slum Act has been referred extensively to provide that area which satisfies the description of Section 4 would be considered as a slum. So that's the first definition of slum in Section 4. The slum has also been defined in DC regulation 3310 in 1991 as well as in 2034 DC regulation, which defines to mean that a area which is censused, measured, and declared and notified as a slum. So this notification would be under Section 4. So that is one definition of a slum under the provisions of DC regulation. Then area which fulfills the conditions of Section 4, though it may not have been declared as slum under Section 4, is also eligible for slum redevelopment under 3310. Then the areas which are declared by SRA as requiring the redevelopment under the Slum Act also would qualify as a slum, as well as area declared by SRA required for the transit camps, etc., also would be considered as a slum. So this is broadly the concept of slum. Now, when we talk about slum, the slums are on the could be on the vacant plots, which were obviously vacant at one point of time and now occupied by slums, or they could be on the pavements, roads, etc. So that's the area which is now considered as a slum. Now, what constitutes a slum has been the subject matter of large number of litigations in the High Court post-1991. And there are a few decisions under which, if you have a doubt about what constitutes a slum, then there are decisions of the High Court which you can refer to, under which you can always get an answer whether a particular area satisfies the definition of slum or not. And those decisions are the famous decision in case of Amba Chaul or Om Sai Darshan, Devendra Kamle. So these are the decisions you find out whether a particular area is a slum or not. Generally, what happens is some people who are opposed to the slum scheme, they contend that their houses are not slums, but they are the original inhabitants of Mumbai with houses of Mangalore tiles, etc. And their houses cannot be classified as slum. Now, these kind of challenges have been rejected by the High Court, holding that if the area or the structure satisfies the description of Section 4 or Para 2 of DCR 3310, then it would qualify as a slum for the purposes of redevelopment under the Slum Act as well as DCR 3310. So that's the first concept to identify where the slum is. The slum could be on a private property or slum could be on government properties. Now, DCR 3310 applies without anything more to the slums on private land or the slums on lands owned by the state government, collector, municipal corporation, or MMRDA, or MADA, that is the state of Maharashtra agencies. Insofar as the other agencies, like the central government or central government agencies are concerned, you cannot submit the scheme without prior consent of the central government or the central government agencies. Insofar as the state government, municipal corporation, and the agencies of the state government are concerned, a scheme can be submitted without their consent. There is a procedure to obtain their consent. And if they do not give consent within the specified time, there is a deemed consent. So that's you have to be careful that the land is not central government or central government agency, because there is no automatic permission in respect of those areas. So DCR 3310 primarily would apply to lands which are private lands or which are owned by the state or state agencies or municipal corporation and not the central government. For central government, a special permission will have to be obtained. If you obtain that permission, a slum scheme can be implemented on those lands as well. So the second aspect is about the land owning authority. The third aspect is about submitting a scheme. Now that entire procedure has been prescribed under DCR 3310, old DCR 3310, as well as new DCR 3310. And that procedure requires that either the owner of the property or the occupiers, the slum dwellers, cooperative society, or their combination, or any other developer with consent of 70% of the occupiers can propose a scheme. 70% was the requirement in 1991 DC regulations, which has now been reduced under the 2034 regulations to 51%. So scheme now can be submitted with 51% consent of the slum dwellers. So that's the next stage of preparation of a scheme. There are various circulars issued by the Government of Maharashtra, Corporation Department, as well as the Urban Development Department, prescribing procedure under which these meetings of the slum dwellers have to be held, because consent has to be recorded in so far as the slum dwellers are concerned by now, in view of these circulars, by video recording in presence of the officers which are nominated, so that in future there is no dispute about whether a particular person has given consent or not. So that's the first stage, which is about submission of the scheme. Now, the procedure for submission of a scheme has been elaborated in a series of, is of course elaborated in 3310, as well as in the brochures which are issued by the Slum Rehabilitation Authority. Now that procedure includes submission of three annexures, that is annexure one, annexure two, and annexure three. Annexure one is the required documents which have to be submitted along, to begin with. Then once that annexure one is submitted, then it is accepted by the Slum Rehabilitation Authority, and on that the scrutiny fee is paid. So your proposal gets accepted. You also need to submit annexure two, which is the list of occupiers on the particular property. Their eligibility may not have been decided at a given point of time, but that eligibility could be decided later. But the annexure 2 contains all the occupiers on that slum, slum pocket, which is listed in annexure 2. And on that basis, the further procedures are taken. Now, this procedure about submission of scheme, you will find elaborately described in at least two or three judgments of the Supreme Court. One of the important judgment is in case of Pramila Suman Singh, where the Supreme Court has elaborated the procedure of submission of the scheme. And what why it is important is, once a particular scheme is submitted, no other scheme can be accepted by the Slum Rehabilitation Authority until this scheme, which is submitted first, has reached a logical conclusion. So these judgments of the Supreme Court, on the basis of which the procedure has been laid, or the Supreme Court has enumerated the procedure which is prescribed in 3310, are the judgments in, as I mentioned earlier, in case of Pramila Suman Singh, then Siktia Construction, the Supreme Court judgment, and the two most important judgments which all lawyers are very familiar and have been using it consistently in all slum matters are the two judgments in case of Audesh Tiwari and Atesh Ahmed. Now, these two judgments are very, very crucial in respect of slum schemes, because once a scheme is submitted with the requisite documents as prescribed in Annexure 1 and Annexure 2, and they are scrutinized and a fee is accepted by the Slum Rehabilitation Authority, then your proposal is deemed to be valid proposal till it reaches its conclusion by issuance of letter of intent, or for certain non-compliances that proposal is rejected. Till these either of the two things happen, that proposal is valid proposal before the Slum Rehabilitation Authority, and no other proposal can be considered by the authority in view of these two judgments in Audesh Tiwari and Atesh Ahmed. Now, the logic for this law is that there should not be horse trading, that once a proposal is submitted with 70% consent and now 51% consent, another developer goes to the slum dwellers, gives them more alluring promises or better scheme, and then attracts them and gets their consent and submits a proposal. Now, this is precisely what is to be avoided as per these two judgments, and therefore, the logic of Audesh Tiwari and Atesh Ahmed's judgment is that once a proposal is submitted, until it reaches its logical conclusion, no other proposal can be submitted. Now, that's the procedure for submission of the scheme before the Slum Rehabilitation Authority. Annexure 3 is the financial statement or financial capabilities of the developer, which is also required to be submitted, which is one of the factors on the basis of which the authority considers the proposal and issues the letter of intent to the to the developer. Now, this is the procedure on behalf of the developer and the proposed cooperative society. The major disputes which arise in this matter is about the eligibility of slum dwellers. Now, eligibility is decided with reference to Chapter 1B. Now, Chapter 1B contains provisions from 3X to 3Z, and they elaborately provide a procedure about how to find out the eligibility of person, and of course, the brochures which are issued from time to time. Broadly, what is required for a slum dweller to be eligible is he must be occupier of that slum prior to the notified date. And that date has been extended from January 80, 85, 90, 95, and currently it is January of 2000. So if a person is in occupation as of 1st of January 2000 in a slum pack, and that he has the requisite documents to establish his possession, such as electoral card or the ration card or electricity bill, etc. These are the documents which will prove the occupation of a person as of 1st of January 2000. So on that basis, the eligibility of the slum dweller is decided, and there is an elaborate procedure prescribed for deciding that eligibility by the competent authority. Now, these are the two or three important phases. We'll discuss that. Competent authority, chief executive officer, because they are tasked with various responsibilities under the Act as well as DC regulations. So the eligibility is decided with reference to the eligibility criteria prescribed in Chapter 1B, that is Section 3X to 3Z. And on that basis, the person is found eligible or held to be ineligible. This decision is challengeable before the appellate authority under Section 33A. And that decision is again further challengeable before the grievance redressal committee, which we'll discuss a little later. So then, as I was discussing, the next stage is to find out the eligibility of a person, the slum dwellers. Then after that comes the issue of issuance of letter of intent by the authority to the developer. Once that issue is, once the letter of intent is issued, then the slum redevelopment begins. And the major issue which happens is about getting the area cleared of the slum dwellers for construction of the rehab building as well as the sale building. Now, for this purpose, the eviction proceedings also have been prescribed under Section 33 with non-cooperative occupants. Then provision of transit camp, that is a mandatory requirement under 33.10 to provide the transit accommodation to the slum dwellers, as well as either the transit accommodation or to provide adequate rent as decided by the slum rehabilitation authority. So that is the next stage by which the redevelopment begins. Then there is a time limit prescribed by the SRA in the LOI, which is generally 36 months for the purposes of completing the scheme. Now, during this period of 36 months, as the development proceeds, there are various hurdles which the developers face because of non-cooperation of slum dwellers or other financial aspects, or permissions not being received, various permissions which are required from the municipal corporation as a planning authority. Of course, for slum projects, the slum rehabilitation authority becomes the planning authority. The other permissions may be required, such as the airport authority or the defense authorities, etc. So the projects get delayed, and the slum dwellers or the cooperative society of slum dwellers desire to change the developer. Now, for that purpose, a procedure has been prescribed in Section 13 of the Act. Now, that procedure again requires a GBR being held, that is general body meeting of the slum dwellers being held under the supervision of the cooperative officer, and that proposal being submitted to the CEO SRA for removal of the builder. Natural justice is required to be followed, and on that basis, the decision is taken, which is again appealable before the grievance redressal committee. Now, what is the procedure for change of developer, etc., has again been elaborated and considered in series of judgments by the Supreme Court. And two important judgments you all possibly remember is the Lokhandwala Infrastructure, Justice Chandrachur's judgment, and High Tech Construction, Justice Wazibdar's judgment on removal of developers under Section 13.2. So that is yet another issue which arises in respect of slum redevelopment. Now, one important aspect in respect of slum redevelopment under 33.10, next is about the actual construction and the construction of resale component as well as rehab component. For this is the basis of the entire slum redevelopment scheme, and that is the FSI which is provided under DCR 33.10. Now, DCR 33.10 of 2034 provides that the FSI available for the slum rehab would be what is required for rehabilitation of the slum dwellers, who are now required to be provided with 300 square feet of carpet area as a rehab component, plus incentive area. And that would be the total FSI, which can exceed, which can be either four. Four is a maximum cap. So the FSI is calculated by two methods. One is you first calculate the area which is required for rehab and the incentive FSI. So that FSI or four, whichever is higher. So even if your FSI exceeds four, because you need rehab plus incentive FSI, if that exceeds four, you will get that FSI because that is more than four. Or if that comes to up to 3, 3.5, etc., then also you will get four, because whichever is higher is the FSI permissible under 33.10. So I repeat again that the FSI required for rehabilitation to provide for the rehab component of the slum dwellers, by providing them 300 square feet of carpet area houses plus incentive FSI, that or four, whichever is more, is the FSI. Now, how does one calculate the incentive FSI? Incentive FSI is calculated on the basis of table which is appended to DCR 33.10, and that incentive FSI depends upon the area of the plot. So the larger the plot, larger is the incentive area, because the idea is to create the housing stock. So if you have a look at that table, which is appended in 3310, new DCR 3310, that will give you an idea how the incentive FSI is calculated. Now, if the entire incentive FSI cannot be consumed on the plot, because the density population is a density, tenement density is also one of the factors which is required to be considered, then you can get that as TDR. The other important aspect is the availability of this incentive FSI also depends upon the width of the road on which the plot abuts. So all that is provided in the table, how to calculate the incentive FSI. But broadly, what we can proceed safely say and proceed is that the FSI available for this scheme is rehab component plus incentive FSI or four, whichever is more. That's the simplest way to say that is the redevelopment potential available on this. Yet another important issue which comes up is if the plot on which the slums are located is reserved for any public purpose under the development plan. Now, the plots, as I mentioned, could belong to private persons, they could belong to state government, belong to municipal corporation, collector, MADA or MMRD. In the development plan, if these plots are reserved, the old 1991 development plan or now 2034 development plan, if that plan, the plot is shown reserved, then there are other issues which are required to be tackled before you undertake the slum redevelopment scheme. The reservations could be of two categories. One is buildable reservations and second is non-buildable reservations. Now, non-buildable reservations like playground, garden, etc., they were considered in a city, there was a judgment, there was a PIL pending, that is city space from 2004. There were PIL filed by the city space was that the plots on which there is a reservation, open reservation like playground or the ground, the such plots should not be redeveloped for slums. Now in that, this High Court had passed orders, series of orders saying that before any slum scheme is sanctioned, they must obtain High Court's permission, and therefore a lot of people used to apply in city space matter and get High Court's permission with assurance and actually demonstrating that they are actually creating open space while proceeding with the slum rehab scheme. So if you are, and the earlier scheme was, if you have a 100 square meter plot on which there is a slum, then you have to create 35% of the open space, and on 65% you could construct the slum rehabilitation scheme. Now that was under the regime that was not provided in the DC regulations of 91, and that's why what it was provided under some government resolutions. So that's why city space judgment and the orders of the High Court were necessary. Now, all that has been provided in the DC regulation, 3310 says that insofar as the redevelopment of plots reserved for non-buildable reservations on which slum exists, they will be redeveloped in accordance with DCR 17D. 17D provides that in such an eventuality, the proposal must contain creation of the open space to the extent of 35%, and on the balance 65%, you can implement a slum rehabilitation scheme. So the city as a city and municipal corporation or the public authority gets 35% plot vacated and also gets the slum redeveloped. So therefore, that's one provision in DCR 17D, which is to be read with 3310 insofar as redevelopment of open plots, redevelopment of plots occupied by slums but reserved for non-buildable reservations. The city space last order which was passed provided that once the new plan comes into force, if that plan is placed by the authorities before the court by filing an affidavit, then no further permissions would be necessary. And I believe that SRA has filed an application putting on record the 2034 plan and the DC regulations. And now, therefore, insofar as slum rehab schemes are concerned, which are to be implemented under 2034, you won't need a permission of the High Court under the city space judgment. You can proceed as per DCR 3310, read with 17B. In insofar as non-buildable or insofar as buildable reservations are concerned, again under 17D, there is a provision made that if, for example, the plot is reserved for municipal school or secondary school or hospital, etc., then in that case, similar requirement is now provided that you will provide construction of a school, construction of secondary school, primary school, municipal school, or hospital, etc., on the specified portion, and on the balance portion, you can construct the, you can proceed with the slum redevelopment scheme. That is in respect of the plots occupied by the slums, which are reserved for buildable reservations. So that's yet another issue which one needs to tackle in implementation of the slum scheme. Now, that's so far as the 3310 implementation is concerned. The building permissions are granted by the Slum Rehabilitation Authority as a planning authority. In fact, Section 354AAA of the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act says that insofar as the planning permissions are concerned under the Town Planning Act as well as under the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act, in respect of slum redevelopment would be granted by the Slum Rehabilitation Authority. Of course, you all remember that under the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act, all provisions for building construction were made, and that was the only town planning law before the Mumbai Town Planning Act of 1921 came and now 1966 Act. So therefore, we have provisions in Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act which provide application being made for planning permission and the permission being granted in a negative manner, that is intimation of disapproval. So intimation of disapproval basically means that the commissioner's order says that your application for planning permission is disapproved subject to the following, which means if you comply with those conditions in that intimation of disapproval, a permission is granted. So it's in a negative form that it is disapproved unless you comply with the following. So that also can be issued by Slum Rehabilitation Authority. However, of course, this SRA has now devise its own procedure and they call it intimation of approval and not intimation of disapproval. So that's the SRA's now jurisdiction as a planning authority, both under Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act as well as under the Maharashtra Regional and Town Planning Act. Now, in while implementing this scheme, the SRA is authorized to issue the permissions as well as commencement certificate simultaneously to both slum rehabilitation component as well as sale component up to 10%. And they proceed to examine how the slum scheme is implementing, and on that basis, they can issue further CCs and further permissions insofar as the sale component is concerned. Now, that is about the practical implementation of the slum rehabilitation scheme as we proceed further. There is also a requirement of construction of transit camp that is mandatory. Either you can construct them in situ or you can construct them somewhere else, but provision of transit camp for the slum dwellers or provision of payment of rent is mandatory, without which no further permissions can be given. And that could be one of the conditions on which an application for removal of developer can be made under Section 13 before the Slum Rehabilitation Authority. So that's how we proceed to implement the slum rehabilitation scheme under 3310. Now, in the major litigation which comes about in the slum rehabilitation project is in respect of acquisition of land. And now, therefore, it is necessary that we first analyze the provisions of the Slum Act. Now, as I mentioned earlier, Chapter 1A, 1B, 1C, which were brought about in 1996 on the basis of Afzalpurkar Committee report, that's a new regime, and that's actually a new act in respect of slum. The old regime under the 1971 Act broadly provided this. First, there was a declaration of a land as a slum. So if the pocket of a slum occupied by structures and building was in an inhabitable condition, unsanitary and unhygienic conditions, then the competent authority could issue a declaration under Section 4, declaring that particular area as a slum. There would be notice to the owner to take remedial steps, and on failure to do that, there would be Section 4 declaration. That Section 4 declaration could be challenged under section subsection 2 before the slum tribunal, which is also constituted under the act. But by and large, the declarations remain unchallenged because the situation actually was as worse as described in the notification itself, and therefore large pockets were declared as a slum. The before Chapter 1B and before 3310 came in, the only remedy in so far as such declared slum was taking the measures for slum rehabilitation or under Chapter 2, 3 and 4 of the Act. Now, under that, under those provisions, the owner was given notice under Section 5 to take remedial measures. If those measures are not taken, then the competent authority under Section 5, 7, 9, etc., could proceed to take further steps. Now, the further steps were under Section 11, to take measures for declaration of that area as a clearance area, remove the buildings and start redevelopment of that particular property. So if all that could, if all that did not materialize, then there was a procedure for acquisition of such property under Section 14. Section 14 contemplated a notice would be given by the competent authority, and on that basis, the proposal for acquisition would be submitted to the state government. State government would then issue notification under Section 14 acquiring the land, and then land would vest in the competent authority in the state government, and which could be utilized for implementation of the slum rehabilitation areas, slum rehabilitation schemes, or for carrying out improvement work. Now, the land which could be acquired was not only the land which was declared under Section 4, but also the land adjoining that slum which was necessary for the purposes of implementation of the improvement work. So that was the acquisition under the provisions, unamended provisions. Of course, they still continue. If there is no 1B, there is no application of Chapter 1A, then this normal procedure, that is Section 5, 11 and 14, would continue. Now, on that is a large litigation which happened in the past on this basis, that whether without following procedure under Section 5 and 11, acquisition under Section 14 could take place or not. And there are those celebrated decisions in the case of Ramkali, Anil Gulabchand, etc., which had held that acquisition under Section 14 without following procedure under Section 5 and 11 was not permissible. Now, those judgments continued to hold field till recently. There is a now judgment of Supreme Court in case of Muralidhar Tekchand, though of course it came in the context of 1B, which we'll discuss, Chapter 1A, which we'll discuss immediately. But the Supreme Court has said that Section 14 of acquisition of this land for the purposes of the improvement works to be carried or development works to be carried out is independent provision, and it is not required to follow any conditions precedent under Section 5 and 11. So the state government can acquire the land under Section 14 if it is satisfied that it is in public interest to do for the purposes of implementation of the improvement work or the development work in respect of the slums or the adjoining areas. The compensation payable is determined under Section 17. These provisions of Section 14 and 17 were challenged before the High Court as being illusory or unconstitutional, violative of Article 14 and 300A of the Constitution. And the High Court has rejected that challenge in case of Sara Hari De Mello, Chief Justice Mohit's judgment. And it has upheld the validity and said that this is a fair compensation, fair in the sense, not necessarily fair, but it is permissible compensation under law, and therefore the provisions of Section 14 and 17 are valid. This Anil Gulabchand and Ramkali kind of Ramkali line of cases now is not valid law in view of the Muralidhar Tekchand's judgment of the Supreme Court, which has held that Section 14 is independent and it need not precede compliance with Section 5, 11 or 5, 11, 12, 13, etc. So because 13 gives right to the landowner, that also we'll discuss, a priority right to develop the property which is declared as a slum or which has characteristics of a slum. So that was the old regime before the amendment under Section 1A, before by Chapter 1A. The amendment to Slum Act by introduction of Chapter 1A, 1B and 1C in 1996 has transformed the entire matter in respect of the slum redevelopments. There are three or four important provisions in this Chapter 1A. First and foremost is Section 3B. 3B empowers the state, the competent authority, to declare a slum rehabilitation scheme for a particular area. So that scheme is to be prepared and declared by the government and the competent authority in respect of a particular area as a draft scheme inviting objections and suggestions. That scheme under Section 3B for Greater Mumbai has been declared and published in April 1998. So anywhere in Mumbai now, the slum rehabilitation scheme, which is declared in 1998, can be implemented by following subsequent procedures. What it basically means is that that scheme has provided what measures could be taken for slum improvement, slum redevelopment, or taking works for improvement of the conditions in the particular area. So that is the slum rehabilitation scheme, which is a general scheme, parent scheme, which is declared for the whole of Mumbai in 1998. Once such a scheme is declared under Section 3B, then there can be declaration under Section 3C as a slum rehabilitation area. This declaration under Section 3C would be for a particular area. 3B is a larger scheme for whole of Mumbai. 3C is a declaration for a particular pocket or a particular area. It could be for one survey number, it could be for more than one survey number, it can be for one pocket, etc. On 3C also, large number of litigation happens, because the question is whether 3C requires a prior hearing to be given to the landowner. Now, there are a large number of judgments in which this issue, whether 3C requires prior hearing to the landowner or not, has been raised and has been decided. Now, 3C, it is contended, is a legislative declaration. When you declare a particular property as it becomes a part of Section 3C, and therefore it is a legislative process, and therefore the arguments are made, and therefore natural justice is not required to be followed before the declaration is made. And in any case, such a declaration is appealable under Section 3C2 before the tribunal, which is constituted under the Slum Act. So if a land is declared as a slum rehabilitation area, then in that case, the owner is entitled to challenge that before the tribunal under Section 3C2. So that's the second stage. The third stage is, after the land is declared as slum rehabilitation area, then in that case, the acquisition of a land, if it is a private land, is on fast track, because then you don't need to go through 5-11 or 4. You can straight away go to 14. And this can be done by CEO SRA, not competent authority. So once there is a 3C declaration, there's a fast track acquisition. A proposal can be submitted by the SRA to the state government under Section 14. And Section 14 has two-tier hearing by the COSRA and then the state government, if state government desires to have any further information. So once that two-tier hearing is contemplated, then there is a Section 14 notification. So private land, which is declared as a slum rehabilitation area under Section 3C, can be acquired on a much faster basis, on a fast-track basis, in view of 3C, straight away 3C going to Section 14. Now, in this context, a very, very important issue arises is, what is the owner's right when a 3C declaration is made? Now, there are a large number of judgments on this aspect, whether owner has a priority right to redevelop the property. Now, there are one or two issues which we must consider in here. Section 3B4 provides that once a 3C declaration is made, the owner is entitled to develop that property. Similarly, Section 13 also provides that the owner has a right to submit a scheme once his plot is declared as a slum rehabilitation area under Section 3C. Now, in this case, how much time the owner should be given? Earlier, before 2012 amendment, 2018 amendment, there was no time limit prescribed. Now, time limit prescribed is that within 120 days from a declaration under Section 3C, the owner must submit the scheme. Otherwise, he loses his preferential right. Now, there are a large number of other issues which arise. Does owner need to give the scheme along with 70% or now 51% consent of the slum dwellers? There are circulars issued by SRA saying that while submitting the proposal, the owner need not give 51% consent of the owners or the individual agreements, etc. However, there is no clarity whether at a subsequent point of time, owner needs to give the consent of more than 51% or 70% as earlier required. Now, therefore, owner can submit a scheme without the consent of the slum dwellers to begin with. Once that scheme is submitted, then the Avadhesh Tiwari logic would apply that his scheme is prior in point of time and therefore no other scheme can be submitted either by any other developer or by any cooperative society or an NGO on behalf of the slum dwellers. So that's the first aspect about the owner. In fact, about 5 years back, the Slum Rehabilitation Authority had issued a public notice inviting all landlords on whose property the slums exist, slum as declared under Section 4 of the Act or slum as defined under Para 2 of DCR 3310. They were called upon to submit the schemes within 120 days of that notice. So that was the first thing which was done by the SRA. Now there is a statutory recognition in Section 3B as well as, Section 3D as well as Section 13 that the landlord does have priority right to submit the scheme. But now there is a time limit of 120 days from the date of declaration under Section 3C. So if landlord does not submit a scheme within 120 days from a 3C declaration, then the authorities are free to proceed to acquire the matter. Now, on this, the High Court has rendered series of judgments and has held that what are the steps the landlord is required to take. Now, those judgments, if you note, those judgments are Muralidhar Tekchand, which is, of course, now finally decided by Supreme Court, Pratap Singh Vallabhdas, Twin and Deccan Builders, Apurva Natala Parikh, Nancy Monji. These are the judgments on considering landlord's rights to submit the scheme. So landlord undoubtedly has the right to submit a scheme, but landlord must actually submit the scheme. In these judgments, the courts have recorded that merely keeping on writing letters to the authority, competent authority or COSRA, or to the state government, that I as a landlord desire to submit the scheme is not sufficient. Mere writing letters or mere expressing your intention to submit a scheme is not sufficient. You must actually submit the scheme. There that SRA circular comes handy for the landlords that to submit the scheme, you don't need the consent to begin with. Whether it is required subsequently or not, it's a gray area, but at least the scheme can be submitted to begin with without the initial consent of 70% or 51%, which is a mandatory requirement for the third party. But landlord may not require such a consent. So landlord must actually submit the scheme. That is what the high courts have said. There is, of course, a different view taken. In the recent judgment, not very recent, I think it's a June 2018 judgment in case of Indian Cork Mills versus State of Maharashtra, where they have said that the landlord, even if he doesn't take proactive step on his part, it is the authority, the SRA must prod the landlord and give opportunity to the landlord, call upon landlord repeatedly to require him to submit the scheme. And until that is done, the state government cannot proceed to acquire the land. In fact, this judgment in Indian Cork has said two or three more things. One is that landlord must be specifically called upon to submit a scheme. That is one. Two, landlord's right is indefeasible. It cannot be taken away by a state saying that now we have received the scheme and therefore now you cannot submit the scheme. Third, there must be application of mine in the order passed by the COSRA in submitting the proposal to the state government why the land needs to be acquired and why landlord's right to submit such a scheme is being defeated. And fourth, the state government also while acquiring the land must record reasons and indicate why the landlord's right is being taken away, which is indefeasible right, and why land is required to be acquired. So these are four important issues which have been held by the High Court in this Indian Cox judgment. Of course, that is pending in Supreme Court. So that's one judgment of High Court where landlord's right has been recognized. Of course, landlord's right does exist, but in what circumstances it is required to be exercised, or if it is not exercised, landlord would be still given some leeway, etc., is held in that judgment of the High Court in Indian Cox. There is yet another judgment of the High Court where landlord's right was accepted, and I think that's the only judgment where acquisition under Section 14 was actually set aside by the High Court in case of Reserve Bank employees. Now, in that case, the land which was acquired was much larger than what was required for the rehabilitation of the slum. There were actually vacant portions in the slum, in that pocket, which were also acquired, which were not occupied by the slum. So, for example, if there was a pocket of 10,000 square meters of land which was acquired, actually the slum was on 3,000 square meters of portion. So therefore, High Court held that it is a mala fide acquisition. And that's only one case where the High Court has actually struck down Section 14 notification acquiring the land. Otherwise, most of these cases, the acquisitions have been upheld. The other case being this Indian Cork Mill, and that is not on the ground of any other issue, but on the ground that the landlord's priority right to redevelop the property has not been allowed to be exploited by the landlord, and therefore the acquisition has been set aside. So this is yet another issue on which large litigation happens. Now there is yet another important point in respect of slum redevelopment scheme, which is 2018 amendment of the Act. In this 2018 amendment Act, there is a new concept which has been brought about, which is the economic activity area in the slum pockets. So that community economic activity area that has been brought about by the 2018 amendment. Now this is specifically brought in for two purposes. The economic activity area is not the slum area. The slum dwellers structures are separate. The economic activity area is the area in which is adjoining or nearby the slum, is used by the slum dwellers for their livelihood, for their activities, commercial activities. And there are two specific examples given in this definition. One is, insofar as fishermen are concerned, their area for drying fish or drying nets or holding nets, etc. So that area is the community economic activity area. So which also will be treated as a part of slum area for the purposes of slum rehabilitation scheme. And this is specifically added for the purposes of the Koliwada areas in Mumbai. Of course, there is a huge opposition to that by the occupants, saying that they cannot be classified as slums. This 2018 definition classifies them as slum areas, and that there is a huge protest from the Koliwada area. There are several Koliwadas in Mumbai. So this definition adds them as a part of the slum because the community economic activity area is included in the definition of slum for the purposes of slum rehabilitation scheme. The second area which is affected by this definition is the Dhobi Ghat areas, because this economic activity area also includes the washing stones or the rassis on which the dhobis dry their clothes, etc. So that area is also included as a part of the slum area. On that also, there is litigation, of course. I think some of you must be handling those litigations also, where the people are protesting against their areas being included as a slum areas, etc. But that's the important amendment which has been brought about in 2018 to include this community economic activity area as a slum area for the purposes of slum redevelopment. So that's the yet another important aspect about the slum redevelopment. Now, in respect of the issue of redressal of grievances arising out of the slum redevelopment scheme, there are a large number of issues which arise, which are like slum dwellers are held ineligible. They think they are eligible, and therefore that issue needs to be decided. The slum dwellers do not get compensation for the rent, or they do not get transit camp, or the developer is not carrying on the construction as expeditiously within time specified in the LOI, or he is carrying out construction contrary to the sanctioned plans by the SRA, etc. So these are various issues which arise, or the developer has delayed the construction of the project so unreasonably that it should not, he should not be allowed to be continued. So these are all various issues which arise in slum redevelopment scheme. Or the normal, of course, which arises is that some new developer comes, he approaches the slum dwellers, he gives them more promises like additional area or additional corpus fund for their proposed society, etc. And they decide that they want to go with the new developer, and the new developer should take over and the old developer should be terminated. So these are all issues which arise in respect of the slum rehabilitation schemes. Now, prior to 2008, before the full bench judgment of Tulsiwadi came in, these issues were raised mostly in writ petitions. So the orders of the Slum Rehabilitation Authority, CO, or competent authority, they were challenged before the High Court in writ petitions because there was no alternate mechanism. The full bench directed the state government to set up a high power committee, which was set up, which was known as Tulsiwadi High Power Committee. So all these issues which I mentioned were then relegated to the High Powered Committee. And there used to be a lot of litigation arising out of the High Power Committee's decision also. So instead of directly coming to High Court, the people used to go to High Power Committee, take a decision from High Power Committee, and then come to High Court challenging that. Now, that was sought to be a change by an amendment brought about in 2012, which provided for creation of Grievance Redressal Committee. But that by amending Section 35 and providing the appellate authority as a grievance redressal committee. That committee eventually was notified in 2017. And under Section 35(1)(a), now there are two committees which are set up under the 2017 resolution. The first committee is known as Apex Grievance Redressal Committee. That committee consists of the additional chief secretary, Vice President MADA, CEO SRA, and Additional Commissioner Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai, and Additional Commissioner MMRDA. So that's the composition of Apex Grievance Redressal Committee, and its jurisdiction is to entertain challenge against order of CEO or any other issue referred to Apex Grievance Redressal Committee by High Court, Supreme Court, or by the state government. Now, this is a little peculiar situation because Apex Grievance Redressal Committee primarily hears appeals against orders of COSRA. And COSRA's order primarily would be under Section 13, a mostly challengeable order for removal of a developer or non-removal of developer. So either party could go to the Apex Grievance Redressal Committee. So COSRA passes an order and he sits on appeal on that committee. Apex Grievance Redressal Committee, he is a part of that. Now, the issue of bias comes in. Can he sit on the committee? So if the same person who has actually passed the order happens to be the CEO when the appeal is heard, you find the minutes recording that he is recusing himself from the proceeding, but he still sits there, he's a part of that committee, etc. And a large number of issues and disputes arise whether this committee is biased because he's sitting on that committee, he can influence the committee's decision, etc. So you will find two important judgments on this about the bias of these members of the HPC, now the Apex Grievance Redressal Committee, that is Advani Builders and Susme Builders. Now, this is a normal administrative law principle which you have to apply in these proceedings and find out whether a committee is biased or not. Now, of course, there would be much substance in this challenge, and possibly the constitution of Apex Grievance Redressal Committee also could be questioned in light of a recent judgment of Supreme Court, which is, of course, in arbitration matter, that is the case of Broadband versus United Telecom, where a party under the arbitration agreement has a right to nominate an arbitrator. Now, the High Supreme Court has said, after the amendment of Arbitration Act in 2015 and 16, the person who has to declare whether he is interested in the subject matter or whether he is biased or not. So if a person has a right to, a person has dealt with the subject matter, he cannot be arbitrator. And therefore the Supreme Court has said if a person cannot be arbitrator himself, he cannot even appoint an arbitrator. And therefore such appointment would be void. Such clauses in the arbitration agreement authorizing one party's, say, chairman, managing director of so-and-so is empowered to nominate arbitrator, etc. Such clause has been held by the Supreme Court to be invalid. So that's the level to which the concept of a likelihood of bias has been now taken in arbitration law. So on that basis, possibly the constitution of Apex Grievance Redressal Committee, in which the decision of COSRA is questioned and COSRA is a part of that, and that can be questioned. Of course, this cannot be saved on the ground of doctrine of necessity because he need not be part of this appellate committee. So that's one committee which has been constituted, that is Apex Grievance Redressal Committee. The second committee which is constituted is known as Grievance Redressal Committee, and that consists of additional collector, joint chief officer of MADA, and deputy municipal commissioner. And there are three or four committees which are constituted, one for island city of Mumbai, one for suburbs, one for Thane, and one for Pune. So these are the grievance redressal committees, and these committees entertain the grievances relating to eligibility of a slum dweller or tenement not being given despite he being eligible, or developer not completing the project in time, or developer not completing the project or constructing the project in accordance with the sanction plans, or the time frame has not been adhered to, or the transit camp not provided, or transit camp is not in the livable condition, or compensation not being paid, etc. So these are various issues which arise, which can be taken to the they can be taken to the and